Hello, my name is Frank Mealy. I'm the president and founder of Pegasus Lectures. Today we're having a lecture on statistics entitled Statistics Made Easy. Now some of you might look at that and say, well, it's clearly a misnomer, statistics can't be easy. Well, if I can't convince you that, hopefully by the end of the lecture I'll at least convince you that it can be made easier. So with that in mind, this is part one. There's at least 8 parts to this. And this first part will cover the lecture overview, describing all the various pieces of the lecture, as well as the general information about statistics. I'm going to do something a little bit out of the ordinary and start off by telling you what this lecture will not be. So this lecture is not to teach a rigorous statistics course. Okay, and I imagine if it were, then a lot of you wouldn't be watching this because most people really don't want to watch a rigorous course on statistics. So this lecture really has a couple purposes. And one is to help you develop more of an intuition as to what statistics can and can't do, and to help you better understand the articles that you read in your field. So quite often we'll find various research papers or articles that will report various things, and it's often based on statistics, but we don't have the background to understand them. And then really, mostly, what I want to achieve is to give you the ability to question things so that you can better develop an understanding of the data and analyses you read, so you can know what you should trust, what you should give less credence to, and perhaps further your understanding of the field. So in terms of lecture outline, this first module is on general information of statistics. And the second module will be statistics and mistakes, so the biggest mistakes commonly made, statistics. Then descriptive statistics, which includes means, medians, and modes, range, variance, and standard deviation, correlation, and the error value. Then we're moving on to inferential statistics, and that will cover hypothesis testing, the meaning of a p-value and the null hypothesis, type 1 and type 2 error. Now, although these next parts here are actually part of inferential statistics, they will stand on their own as modules, so that will give me the ability to go further in depth in each one individually. And this last section right here, highlighted in red, will not be in the same format. They'll be included in what's in the e-course format I recorded previously, and those are available online for a small fee. Okay, so the idea of sensitivity, specificity, negative and positive predictive values, and accuracy. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about statistics in general. Well, I'm sure many of you have heard this expression, lies, damn lies, and statistics. In fact, just a couple weeks ago, I was listening to the news and I heard a congressman use this expression to refer to poll data that he had heard that he didn't believe in. And clearly the implication here is that statistics are associated with lies and even damn lies. This was popularized somewhat by Mark Twain, and many people attribute it to Mark Twain, although it certainly goes back previous to Mark Twain, Lord Courtney in 1895, and probably well before then. Now, given the fact that there's this belief or this feeling about statistics as being associated with lies and prevarication, it certainly makes sense to develop a healthy skepticism, and it does make sense. You have to be a little bit careful about statistics. However, I believe that assuming that all statistics represent falsehoods is just as ill-informed as blindly putting credence in all statistics. And I further believe that statistics are an extremely powerful tool when used appropriately. Given the appropriate amount of care and caution and thought, statistics can pull a world of information out of what looks like just a pile of incomprehensible data. So we don't want to dismiss all statistics, but we do want to have a healthy skepticism and also develop some intuition as to what makes sense and what doesn't. So the question is, why do people mistrust statistics? As we just saw, they're lies and damn lies, right? So why is it? Well, this is my opinion, and I'm sure there's other reasons as well. But the first one, I believe, is that statistics are commonly used, sometimes correctly, sometimes incorrectly, to support political opinions. So what happens? You see two sets of conflicting statistics, one that supports one side, one that supports the opposing side. You say, well, they can't both be right, so therefore you trust neither. Or, as many people are prone to do, you trust the one that supports your opinion more. Regardless of whatever makes the most sense, you pick the one that supports what you want to believe. Now, what about medical statistics? Well, they're often confused or confusing, and seemingly support one position one week and a different position the next week. I'm sure that you've all seen times where a certain drug or a certain diet or a certain behavior is considered good for you one week, and then 3, 4, 5 weeks, a couple months later, a another report comes out that says states the exact opposite. Well, since statistics are used to support the theory, and then you hit a conflicting theory, and what happens? People start to doubt the statistics instead of the people who did the actual research or the actual analysis of the data. Furthermore, statistics are often based on the logical assumptions. People start off with bad assumptions and then use statistics, and so people associate the statistics with the bad assumptions. Or sometimes, statistics are given without a clear reference to the assumptions made. So, if you don't understand the assumption, you may start off with a different assumption, and then the whole thing becomes illogical. And here's another reason. Statistics requires mathematics, which, as we know, often causes palpitations and shortness of breath in many people. So, there are times where there's a misrepresentation of statistical results, but it's not the result of malice or conscious attempt to obfuscate reality. And sometimes people are really trying to do a good job, but in reality, it's because the experiment was poorly executed, or the process of collecting or analyzing the data was poor, or even sometimes it may just be because there's a lack of information. And so the person could have been completely diligent, done everything they possibly could, but there's some information that's not known yet that would have helped make clarity out of the data, and so we end up with spurious results. So let's work a little bit on dispelling the myths. To better understand statistics, we will define some types of statistics. So the first thing is we have to know a definition. What does statistics really mean? We'll discuss some of the most common errors. Then we'll review some descriptive statistical tools, and some that you've actually learned very early on in school. Okay? You see that term descriptive, like describe. Okay? And then we're going to discuss the real significance of these tools as well as the limitations. Then we're going to learn more powerful and advanced tools which can be used to infer conclusions from collections of data. And you'll see these terms come up over and over again. Descriptive, okay, but to describe the data, okay, or what the data actually looks like, versus inference, which means to extrapolate, to take that data and to project it out into what it actually means. Okay? So there's two real aspects to it, descriptive and inferential. So here's some definitions of statistics. And the first one I took from Merriam-Webster, and perhaps it won't give you any meaning yet, but we'll put it together in a moment. So let's just look at the definition. It says, a branch of mathematics dealing with the collection, analysis, interpretation, and presentation of masses of numerical data. Or second definition, a collection of quantitative data. Well, that probably doesn't give you too much intuition, so let's look at another one. This one was taken out from an online source of Princeton. It says, a branch of applied mathematics concerned with the collection and interpretation of quantitative data and the use of probability theory to estimate population parameters. Well, probably again, it doesn't give you a whole warm, fuzzy feeling, so let's look at a third one. This was taken from Wikipedia. Statistics is the science of making effective use of numerical data related to groups of individuals or experiments. Now, that one actually seems to be a little bit closer to home and probably a little bit more understandable, but let's look at those three taken together. What's in common? Well, clearly, statistics deals with mathematics. It's a branch of mathematics, and it deals with collections of data and then the interpretation of the data, such that predictions can be made about a population. Now, what does it mean by a population? Well, that population can refer to people or groups of people. It can refer to salaries, refer to housing costs, or maybe parts of it that are being created on an assembly line. Okay? But the bottom line is there, that statistics really deals with data and then the interpretation of that data so we can predict something about a population. Now, there are different types of statistics. As I've already implied a couple slides back, there's descriptive statistics, which describes the data collected. Okay, so we have things like means and median values and variance and things like that. Then there's inferential, which is a collection of statistical approaches which draw from data conclusions in what we infer, which extend a reach beyond the data itself. Okay? So since we're taking the data and then we're extrapolating from that to say what that data actually means outside of the data itself. Now, there's a third type, and although we won't be going into this, it's good to know about it, recognize, called Bayesian. And really, the Bayesian approach is to use the same statistical tools, but now what we're going to do is add in what's called a priori information. A priori means in advance of, beforehand. So really what it is we're going to take other information to help improve our statistical modeling so we can better predict what's going to happen. Okay? So in other words, we may either use information from an expert or from previous research, and from that we will use that to help seed the equations to help better predict what's going to happen. Now, to understand part of the fear of statistics, we have to realize that it comes down to looking at these math symbols, which often look quite scary. And in fact, for most people, they say, wow, this looks like Greek. And there's a good reason for that. The symbols actually are Greek. So to take some of that fear out, we're going to spend a little bit of time learning about a couple of math symbols. Before I do that, I want to just point out a couple of things so you don't get too panicky about when you see the symbols. So let's ask a couple of questions. What is the probability that you'll ever have to do extensive calculations by hand? Well, unless you're in a rigorous statistics course, the answer is virtually zero. You will not have to do extensive calculations by hand. Let's ask another question. What's the probability that you'll have to understand the equations to be able to produce statistical calculations? And the answer again is virtually zero. Okay? Because these days, you can generate statistical calculations by entering data into a spreadsheet and then click on a couple buttons or two. Right? So the point is not, by showing you the equations, is not to get you to the point where you're going to do the calculations or to scare you, but rather say that if you can start to understand the equations, okay, you won't have to do the calculations, but if you start to understand the equations, then you'll better understand the results and then be better able to predict and interpret those results correctly. Whereas, if you just shove numbers into a data sheet, you click a button, the results come up, you won't have any idea what they actually mean without having first looked at least at what the equations are trying to do and why they're trying to do what they're doing. So, with this said, this is why we're going to spend a few minutes on some basic math symbols, and later on, we'll look at the equations, but probably in a very different perspective. Okay? Not from the perspective of having to do extensive calculations, but rather, really, what does the equation mean intuitively? Okay? So the first symbol we're going to look at is this Greek letter sigma. Those of you who remember your college days and fraternities will recognize that symbol probably from some of the frat houses. Okay? It's the Greek letter sigma, and it stands for the word summation, which means addition. Okay? So, this symbol here, summation, means addition of. Now we have to understand one more parameter here. This letter I right here stands for the word index. So what we're saying is, we're going to add up a whole series of values of x indexed by I. So in this case, let's say that we collect the data, we have a whole bunch of data points. We say we're going to add up the first data point plus the second point plus the third point, dot, 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 until we get to the nth data point. Or in other words, as I runs from 1 to n. So we have n data points. Okay? So you can see this symbol is basically saying we're going to add up all the x values, and then we can tell you how many x values are going to be by putting an index in front. Okay? So that's all that symbol means. It just means addition of or sum of. Why is it valuable? Well, let's say you collect data and you actually do a study in which you have 1,000 patients or 10,000 patients or 100,000 patients even. By using the symbol, we can now specify that we want to add up all 100,000 without having to write out each one. We don't have to write out add up x1, x2, dot, 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 up to x1,000. Instead, we can just use a symbol and say as I runs from 1 to 1,000, add up all the data. Okay? Now, there's also something else we can do. Let's say that we took data on 1,000 patients. But we know that the patients from number 200 to 300, they were ones that were done at a certain hospital or on a certain date that we'd really like to look at just those and pull just those out. What we can do is we can say, okay, let's just look at the patients between 100 and 200. Okay? And now add up all those. So it's a really nice notation. It's a nice short way of writing out lots and lots of addition, and that's really all the tool does for us. Okay? So to really understand it, let's try an example. We'll always use a small number of numbers so that it's not too much effort. So let's say I have this is my data set. So these are my x values, 2, 7, 9, 1, and 3. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 values. So we say I runs from 1 to 5. So the sum of all my x values, this data is x, is 2 plus 7 plus 9 plus 1 plus 3, or 22. Okay? Now there's one more symbol we need to have, and that is if we put a bar over the top of a variable, that bar stands for the mean, or the average. And we know how to take a mean or an average. We just add up all the values, and then divide by the number of values we have. Right? So quite simply, Whenever we have a bar over a variable, it just means take the average or the mean. So, that's it. That's really all you need to know about math symbols. You may see combinations of them, but it's really no scarier than that. Okay? Well, with that, we've ended part one. Okay? And in part two, we're going to review some of the situations and related statistics to get a better appreciation for the biggest statistical errors. And hopefully that will start to give you a better intuition as to what statistics can and can't do and how they're often misused. So that really, as I said at the beginning, we want to help develop that intuition to become better at interpreting the data that we see. I look forward to seeing you in module 2.